I guess we need to understand first how ATP releases energy. All right? Now, in order to understand how ATP releases energy, we need to have a thorough understanding of the structure of the molecule. Now, ATP or adenosine triphosphate by the name itself is composed of an adenosine group. Let me correct my visual aid. No? So, ribose and adenine makes up the adenosine component of ATP. No, that should be adenine, not adenosine. All right? So, you have ribose. We know that ribose is a major component of RNA. And adenine is also a major component of the nucleic acids, right? DNA and RNA. So, come to think of it, ATP is a relative of the nucleic acids. Alright, so adenine and ribose forms the adenosine component. And attached to the ribose sugar are three phosphate groups. Okay? So that's why I mentioned here in this slide that the structure of ATP is composed of a base, adenine, all right, attached to a ribose sugar. So collectively, you call that adenosine. And attached to ribose are three phosphate groups. Now, let's label the three phosphate groups. So the phosphate group that is directly attached to ribose, we will just label it as P3. Okay, P3 yan. Then the phosphate group at the middle is P2. And the phosphate group at the distal end is P1. Right? So from ribose palabas, so P3, P2, P1. Alright, class? Sige, so this is adenosine. Adenosine is composed of adenine attached to a ribose sugar. And attached to the ribose sugar are three phosphate groups. So this is P3, at the middle P2, and the phosphate at the distal end is P1. Alright, now let's talk about now the bonding. Now between P1 and P2, you have a phosphoanhydride bond. Alright, you call that a phosphoanhydride bond or a high energy bond. Okay, this bond is quite unstable. All right, and between P2 and P3 is also a phosphoanhydride bond. Okay, so dalawa yung phosphoanhydride bonds in ATP. So between P1 and P2, and between P2 and P3. Now between P3 and ribose, this is just an ordinary covalent bond. Alright, so the question now is, how does ATP releases energy? Alright, so ATP releases energy by breaking the phosphoanhydride bond. So it begins here at the phosphoanhydride bond between P1 and P2. So this bond is broken, again, through hydrolysis. Alright, then the energy is released, all right? And what remains is a phosphate group, all right? So ATP minus phosphate, ATP becomes adenosine diphosphate, all right? And the high energy bond, the energy contained in that phosphoanhydride bond is released as energy to be used by the cell for its metabolic activities. Alright, so ATP becomes adenosine diphosphate. Now, in adenosine diphosphate, you have another phosphoanhydride bond. Diba? Meron pa itong phosphoanhydride bond. Now, technically, this phosphoanhydride bond can still be used by the cell for energy. Kasi may energy pa rin yan eh. Alright? But in reality, the cell doesn't use ADP anymore. So what happens is that ADP is recharged back to ATP by adding a phosphate group. Okay, guys? So this recharging of ADP to ATP is cellular respiration. All right, that's the function of cell respiration. Siguro isama na natin yung photosynthesis kasi ganun din eh, di ba? In photosynthesis, ATP also is generated through photophosphorylation, if you will recall. Ito naman, ATP is regenerated from ADP using energy from food molecules naman. All right? Okay, so what happens here is that ADP is recharged back to ATP. Okay? By adding a phosphate group. By the way, the addition of a phosphate group is called phosphorylation, di ba na? I think I have already mentioned that term when we studied photosynthesis, no? Phosphorylation. All right, it is easier to recharge ADP to ATP kasi you need only one phosphate group. Only one phosphate group is added. All right? Now, baka magtanong kayo, bakit hindi ginagamit ng cell ang ADP? Now, for example, if the cell uses ADP as energy, the P2, yung phosphate 2, is released, the high energy bond is broken, and again, the cell uses some of its energy. So, ADP becomes adenosine monophosphate. Okay, in recharging adenosine monophosphate back to ATP, how many phosphate groups would you need to recharge AMP back to ATP? You need 2. Di ba? Mas mahirap yun. Alright? The cell will be consuming more energy than to regenerate it. Di ba? Kaysa sa ADP to ATP, you need only one phosphate group to be added. This is the reason why the cell recharges ADP to ATP. Hindi na sa AMP. Parang ano yan, no? It's like charging your cell phone. Diba, normally when you charge your cell phone, siguro mga 20% lang of energy remaining, you recharge your phone right away. Kasi pag fully drained yung battery, mahirap, matagal yung charging time, and medyo umiinit yung charger kasi nahihirapan siya mag-add ng energy dun sa battery. Kasi fully drained siya eh. Unlike if the battery is 20% remaining, yung energy remaining is 20% or 10%, that's the time you recharge your phone. It's the same with this, no? So, you need only one phosphate group to recharge ADP back to ATP. And that's the function of cellular respiration. Alright, class? Okay, so like what I mentioned, the phosphoanhydride bond is broken through hydrolysis. The energy is released, and that energy is used by the cell for its metabolic activities. Then a phosphate group is released, so ATP becomes ADP. Ayun. And the ADP is recharged again back to ATP through cellular respiration. Alright, so before we move on, let us now again review, I'm sure you are familiar with this, the structure of the mitochondria. So again, the mitochondria is said to be the powerhouse of the cell. This is where cell respiration occurs. Alright, now the mitochondria is composed of 2 membranes. It is a double membrane organelle, very similar to the chloroplast. Alright, so you have an outer membrane. And an inner membrane. The outer membrane is smooth, just like the chloroplast, while the inner membrane is folded, no, as you could see in this illustration. The foldings of the inner membrane will increase the surface area for cell respiration to occur. The foldings of the inner membrane are called cristae. Okay? And inside the mitochondria is a fluid-filled space. That fluid-filled space is known as the matrix, no? The mitochondrial matrix. And the space between the outer and the inner membrane, ito yung puti na yan, may important role din yan na ginagampanan sa cell respiration, as I will mention later. So, this region between the outer and the inner membrane is called the inner membrane space. Alright? Okay, so bakit again nabanggit ko itong mga structure na to ng mitochondria? Again, because In the matrix, that's where the Krebs cycle occurs. No, and in the cristae, that's where the electron transport chain occurs. Alright, actually cell respiration is composed of a three-step biochemical pathway. At alam niyo na ito siguro, no? So you have glycolysis, Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain. Now, when we speak of cellular respiration, this is, ayan, a set of metabolic reactions. Actually, there are three metabolic reactions involved in the cells of organisms to convert glucose, that's the raw material and that's the source of energy, into adenosine triphosphate. Now, ATP again is the energy currency of the cell. Yun yung ginagamit ng cell as its energy source. So, yung glucose, which contains energy, di ba, na galing sa plants, remember, di ba, ang byproduct ng photosynthesis is glucose. So, actually, na-convert yung solar energy ng sun into chemical energy in the form of glucose. And yun yung gagamitin ng cell, no, to be converted into adenosine triphosphate. Alright? So, basically, that's cell respiration. Alright, and like what I mentioned, cell respiration is a three-step biochemical pathway. So first we have glycolysis, this is followed by the Krebs cycle and the electron transport chain. The Krebs cycle occurs in the matrix, the mitochondrial matrix. Kaya binanggit ko yung ano, structure ng mitochondria. The electron transport chain, which is, by the way, similar to the electron transport chain that occurs in the thylakoid membrane of the chloroplast. Di ba naalala niyo yun dun sa cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation? Alright? So, this electron transport chain occurs in the cristae. Alright? Okay, what about glycolysis? Now, glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm, hindi yan sa mitochondria. Glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm. Alright? Sige, so tuloy na natin. Let's first study the biochemical pathways involved in glycolysis. So, by the term itself, glyco refers to sugar. Lysis means to break or to split. So, glycolysis means splitting or breaking down sugar into a molecule called pyruvic acid. Alright? Now, glycolysis does not need oxygen. No? It doesn't need oxygen to continue with the reactions. Alright? So, we call this anaerobic respiration. Glycolysis is a type of anaerobic respiration. Alright? And glycolysis produces ATP. Okay, this is through substrate level phosphorylation. Yeah, mamaya babanggitin ko, we will go into the details of that. So glycolysis produces ATP through substrate level phosphorylation. All right, it serves as a first step in a variety of energy harvesting reactions. Ito yung una, no? Glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm of cells, not in a specialized organelle like the mitochondria. Alright, so sa cytoplasm lang to. So what does this mean? No, it means that glycolysis is a very primitive reaction. Glycolysis occurs in all living organisms, even in prokaryotes. Diba mga prokaryotes, they don't have any major organelles. Wala silang mitochondria, yung mga prokaryotes like bacteria and the blue-green algae. So, wala silang ano? Wala silang Krebs cycle. Diba? Wala silang ETC. Pero meron silang glycolysis. Now, glycolysis occurs in all living things. So, very primitive na ito. This occurs even in prokaryotic cells. Ayan, alright? Okay, so moving on, here is a simplified diagram of what occurs in the glycolytic pathway of glucose, converting it into two molecules of pyruvic acid. Yun ang breakdown ng glucose to pyruvic acid. So that's glycolysis. glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm or the cytosol. So our raw material here is glucose, and there are series of biochemical reactions in order to convert glucose into two molecules of pyruvic acid with the release of two NADH. So alam niyo na yung NADH, no? NADH stands for nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide hydrogen. So NAD is a hydrogen carrier molecule similar to NADPH sa photosynthesis, no? Kaya lang ito walang phosphate, no, NADH lang. So alam niyo na ang ibig sabihin pag may NADH. So there is redox reactions here, no? Alright, kasi NADH that affects redox, diba? So when a molecule receives hydrogen, oh, that's reduction. When a molecule releases hydrogen, that's oxidation, diba? Alright, so NADH, that's the reduced form of the molecule. Pag NAD lang, yun yung na-oxidize, no? Alright, and glycolysis also produces two molecules of ATP. Okay? Yan, mamaya malalaman nyo kung paano nagawa yung ATP na yan. Alright, so let us now proceed into the details of the glycolytic breakdown of glucose. Alright, now glucose is quite a stable molecule. Diba galing yan sa plants, no? Byproduct yan ng photosynthesis ng plants. So, medyo mahirap siyang, itap yung energy niya. So we must make glucose unstable, no, so that we can harness its energy. All right. So in order to activate or to make glucose unstable, we need to add energy. Parang ano yan, no, guys? Para ka nagbasag ng itlog, di ba? Di ba? If you want to crack the egg, anong gagawin niyo? Di pupukpukin niyo, di ba? So you will apply energy para mag-crack nyo yung egg. It's the same thing with this. Kailangan lang natin i-crack yung egg ng glucose. So, we need energy. Saan natin kukunin yung energy na yan? That energy would come from ATP. So, gagamit tayo ng ATP in order to activate glucose or to make it unstable. Alright? Okay, so alam na natin how ATP releases energy. So, ATP, phosphate, 1 and 2 na hydrolysis, so yung phosphoanhydride bond is broken, so the phosphate group is released, so ATP becomes adenosine diphosphate, di ba? All right, then yung phosphate na yan will attach to glucose. So in short, glucose is phosphorylated. Alright, kasi may addition na ba phosphate group sa glucose? So, glucose is phosphorylated. Okay, by the reaction of ATP. A phosphate group is added to glucose forming, ngayon molecule na to? So, you call this glucose phosphate? Yun na yun, glucose phosphate. Alright, now glucose phosphate is now partially activated. Hindi pa siya fully activated or hindi pa siya fully unstable. Okay, so that means we need one more molecule of ATP to fully activate or to make glucose fully unstable. So before ATP reacts to glucose phosphate, there are enzymes that will rearrange the molecules of glucose para mas madaling basagin yung or maging unstable yung glucose. So kailangan mo nang rearrange yung mga atoms ng glucose. All right, into its isomer. Ano ba yung mga isomers ng glucose? Edi fructose saka galactose, pero fructose yung gagamitin. So, ano yung mga enzymes involved? So, the enzymes involved are phosphoglucoisomerase. I hope my mind is serving me right. Phosphoglucoisomerase and phosphofructokinase. Alright? Anyway, recorded naman to, no? So, kindly jot that down. The two enzymes are the following. Phosphoglucoisomerase isomerase, kasi magiging isomer siya, glucose becomes fructose yung isomer niya. And phosphofructokinase. Ayan, no? Alright, guys? So, these enzymes will rearrange the atoms of glucose. Ayan, forming fructose phosphate. O, diba? So, yung fructose phosphate, parang ano lang yan, rearrange version ng glucose phosphate. Na para mas madali siyang gawing unstable. Alright? Okay, so again, what are those two enzymes? So, phosphoglucoisomerase and phosphofructokinase. Alright? Okay, so moving on, what happens now to fructose phosphate? So, dito na ulit papasok ang ATP. Ayan, no? So, ATP reacts with fructose phosphate. So, the usual, ATP releases its energy, removing a phosphate group. ATP becomes adenosine diphosphate. And the phosphate group, itong natanggal na phosphate, attaches to fructose phosphate. So, fructose phosphate now becomes what? Fructose diphosphate. Ayan, no? Diba? Kumabit yung phosphate group dito sa fructose phosphate, forming fructose phosphate. Ayan. Diphosphate. Fructose diphosphate. Kasi dalawa na yung phosphate groups na kumabit. This will make fructose diphosphate chemically unstable. Ayan, no? Fructose diphosphate. So, fully activated na siya. Okay? Kumbaga yan sa itlog, talagang maghihiwalay na, no? Pero hindi pa siya fully nahiwalay. So, there is an enzyme that will facilitate the splitting of fructose diphosphate. The enzyme is aldolase. Alright? So, aldolase will facilitate the splitting of fructose diphosphate kasi unstable na siya and fully activated into two molecules of PGA. PGA stands for phosphoglyceraldehyde. Ayan, no, diba? Naghati sila ng phosphate. So, PGAL contains a phosphate group. Tigi-isa sila. Alright? Okay. Ah, sige. So, ituloy muna natin, guys. So, if you will notice, in this part of the reaction, we have consumed, or the cell has consumed, two molecules of ATP in activating glucose to fructose diphosphate, forming phosphoglyceraldehyde. Tuloy natin, guys, yung ating kwentuhan sa glycolysis. Alright, so what happens now to PGAL? Alright, PGAL. Dito ngayon tayo. Now, sige, bago tayo pumunta sa PGAL, itong reaction na ito, this part of glycolysis, is known as the energy investment phase. Ayan, no? Bakit tinawag na energy investment? Eh kasi nga gumamit tayo or humiram tayo ng dalawang ATP to activate glucose to fructose diphosphate, di ba? Energy, nag-invest tayo ng energy to make glucose unstable. Yun lang yan. So let's review the different reactions involved. Alright, so in step number one, ayan, di ba? In step number one, glucose enters the cell. And is phosphorylated. Diba? Naalala nyo may kumabit na phosphate group sa glucose. Ayan, by the transfer of a phosphate group from ATP. So, an ATP molecule reacts with glucose. So, a phosphate group is released. That phosphate group is added to glucose, no, forming glucose phosphate. Now, this will make glucose more chemically reactive or partially activated. Yung pag-add ng phosphate sa glucose, forming glucose phosphate. So, that's step one. Alright? In the energy investment phase. Okay, then in step number two, what happens? So, the atoms of glucose undergo rearranging, no, by the two enzymes. Naalala nyo yung phosphoglucoisomerase and phosphofructokinase. Alright, forming fructose phosphate. Diba? Naalala niyo yun. Then in step number 3, fructose phosphate reacts with another molecule of ATP. And a phosphate group is added to fructose diphosphate, forming fructose diphosphate, which is now fully activated form of glucose, which is now unstable. So an enzyme aldolase will split the molecule, fructose diphosphate, into PGAL. Yan, fructose diphosphate splits through the enzyme aldolase into two molecules of PGAL or phosphoglyceraldehyde. So those are the reactions involved in the energy investment phase. Energy investment kasi nga gumamit tayo ng ATP in activating glucose to fructose diphosphate, forming PGAL. Okay, so I guess dito na tayo sa PGAL, part 2 of glycolysis. So what happens now to PGAL? Now, PGAL will undergo redox reactions with NAD. Oh, diba? So alam niyo na yung nature ng NAD, no? NAD is a hydrogen carrier molecule. Alright? So NAD is reduced, no, by taking a phosphate, ano, not a phosphate, a hydrogen to PGAL. So ang NAD, magnanakaw siya or kukuha ng hydrogen dito sa PGAL. So NAD is reduced while PGAL is oxidized, forming NADH. Diba? So redox yan. So NAD is reduced to NADH while PGAL is oxidized. Alright, so nawalan ngayon siya ng hydrogen, ng PGAL. This will create a molecular vacancy. Diba? Parang sa photosynthesis, naalala nyo yung tumalon yung mga electrons, diba? Alright, so that created a molecular vacancy. Now, to fill up that vacancy, a phosphate group is added to PGAL. No? May kakabit na phosphate group. Ngayon, baka magtanong kayo, saan ba galing yung phosphate group na yan? Sa ATP ba? No. That phosphate group comes from the cytoplasm because the cytoplasm is a reservoir of many compounds, di ba? Kaya ito yung nag-o-occur sa cytoplasm. Alright, so a phosphate group from the cytoplasm attaches to PGAL. Forming what? Forming, ayan na, phosphate group from the cytoplasm attaches to PGAL, forming di-PGAL. Diba? Okay, kaya lang, di ba ang natanggal is hydrogen. Di ba ang hydrogen, maliit na molecule lang yan. Tapos ang kumabit ay malaking molecule, a phosphate group, medyo malaking molecule yan. So kung bagayan sa ano, maliit na upuan, tapos inupuan ng malaking tao. Ganon, that will make the chair unstable, di ba? Di ba guys, kunyari, may, yung upuan, pambata, ay umupo, malaking tao. O di ba, that will make the chair unstable. It's the same with this. Ang nawala, hydrogen, pero ang kumabit ay malaking molecule. This will make di-PGAL unstable. Alright, guys? So, ang mangyayari dito, di-PGAL now, para maging stable siya ulit, will release that phosphate group, tatanggalin niya yung phosphate group ulit. Kasi unstable siya eh. Alright, guys? So, a phosphate group is released. Saan ngayon kakabit yung phosphate group na yan? Sa ADP. So, a phosphate group plus ADP, you form ATP. E magkabilaan yan, di ba? So, the reaction produces two molecules of ATP. Ayan, no? So, two ATP molecules and di-PGAL becomes PGA. Alright? Or phosphoglyceric acid. Okay, so far so good, guys. Alright, and eventually, PGA with its remaining phosphate group, that phosphate group is released and that phosphate is added to ADP. Again, magkabilaan yan. So you have two ADP molecules accepting the phosphate group. So that produces two more molecules of ATP, and PGA becomes pyruvic acid. That's it. That's glycolysis. All right. Now this part of the reaction, part two of glycolysis, is known as the energy yielding phase. Now, energy yielding kasi dito sa part ng reaction, nakapag-produce ng ATP. Hindi tayo umutang ng ATP. Dito tayo nakapag-produce ng ATP. Alright? Okay, so let us now again identify the reactions involved. So, saan ba tayo nag-start? Sa PGAL, di ba? PGAL. So, PGAL undergoes redox, no? By reacting with NAD. So, NAD is reduced, di ba? Nag-accept siya ng hydrogen or kumuha siya ng hydrogen sa PGAL. Alright? While PGAL is oxidized. And ang bangit dito, NAD reacts with PGAL and is reduced. So, naging NADH siya. While PGAL is oxidized. Alright? Forming NADH. This redox reaction will trigger phosphorylation of PGAL. Kasi hindi man nagkaroon ng molecular vacancy. Okay, saan galing yung phosphate sa cytoplasm? Forming di-PGAL, which is unstable. Di ba yung kinikwento ko na malit yung upuan pero malaki yung umupo? Di ba that makes di-PGAL unstable? So what happens here is that the phosphate group is released. Okay, a phosphate group that was added to di-PGAL is transferred to ADP, forming ATP, dalawang ATP, and di-PGAL becomes PGA or phosphoglyceric acid. Okay, and in the final reaction, PGA releases and donates its remaining phosphate group to ADP, dalawang ADP yan, forming ATP. PGA becomes pyruvic acid. Alright? Okay, class, is that clear? Any questions? Alright. Okay, gawa naman tayo ng accounting. Now, let's do an accounting of what's released and what reacted in glycolysis. Alright, so ang nangyari dito in the energy investment phase, we used up two molecules of ATP, di ba? Umutang tayo o gumamit tayo ng dalawang molecules of ATP in activating glucose to fructose diphosphate. Then in the energy yielding phase, if you will recall, dalawa, no? Ano na dalawa? Apat na ATP ang na-produce. No, yung isa galing sa PGAL to PGA, kasi nagkaroon ng redox, and PGA to pyruvic acid. So, dalawa-dalawa, apat. Alright, plus, yung sa redox reaction, nakapag-release ng NADH, ang glycolysis. Yan. And you have two molecules of pyruvic acid. Alright, class? Ah, sige. So, ang net ngayon yan, ilan yung mga nilabas? So, glycolysis produces two molecules of pyruvic acid. And how many ATPs all in all? Apat. Apat, di ba? Yun yung gross. Kaya lang, umutang tayo dun sa sa unang part ng reaction. Di ba, gumamit tayo ng ATP. So, kailangan natin bayaran yun. Alright, kasi nag-invest tayo ng dalawang ATP para ma-activate yung glucose. So, dapat bayaran yun. So, ang net ATP lang ay dalawa. Pero, kung tutusin nyo apat, di ba nakikita nyo apat na ATP? Pero, kailangan natin bayaran yung dalawang ATP dun sa energy investment phase. So, ang net ATP lang sa glycolysis is 2. Plus, you have 2 molecules of NADH. Alright, class. So that's it. That's the glycolytic pathway of glucose. Okay, ngayon ang tanong, ano mangyayari sa pyruvic acid na na-produce ng glycolysis? Alright? Okay, so yung ATP muna. E di yung ATP, yung dalawang ATP, gagamitin ng cell. Yung energy niyan. Alright? Yung NADH, saan ano yan, ano mangyayari sa NADH? Pupunta yan sa electron transport chain. But I will explain that later. Okay, what happens now to pyruvic acid? Now, pyruvic acid will enter the mitochondria depending on the presence of oxygen. Okay? Ganito yan, guys. Depende sa oxygen. Ngayon, pag may oxygen, if there is oxygen, if oxygen is present, then pyruvic acid enters the mitochondria and it will undergo a transition reaction bago mag-react sa Krebs cycle. Alright? Okay. So, doon ngayon pumapasok yung oxygen. That's why animals, including us, we take in oxygen kasi dito gagamitin yung oxygen na yan. Okay? Now, ang tanong, what about if there is no oxygen? Pag walang oxygen. Now, pyruvic acid, in the absence of oxygen, in the absence of oxygen, pyruvic acid will undergo fermentation. Alright? O sige, mamaya na natin muna pag-usapan itong transition reaction. Pag-usapan muna natin itong fermentation. So, in the absence of oxygen, pyruvic acid undergoes fermentation. There are two types of fermentation. Fermentation in the animal cell or animal cell fermentation and plant cell fermentation. So, ito yung pyruvic acid, no? In the presence of oxygen, pyruvic acid will undergo a transition reaction. So, pupunta yan, it will enter the mitochondria in the presence of oxygen. Now, in the absence of oxygen, in the animal cell, no, sa animal cell, the pyruvic acid will undergo redox with NADH. So, NADH is oxidized while pyruvic acid is reduced into lactic acid. Alright? Okay, anong yun ang ano nito? Ang relevance ng lactic acid. O, diba, pag kunyari, if you are doing a physical activity like running or swimming, diba, your body needs more oxygen. So, in a way, ang katawan natin is deprived of oxygen. Okay, kasi habang nag-exercise kayo, habang tumatakbo kayo or nagsiswimming, the demand for oxygen is increasing. No? So, medyo nadideprive na yung katawan natin ng oxygen. So, papasok ngayon dito yung fermentation sa mga animal cells. Okay? So, NADH is oxidized to NAD while pyruvic acid is reduced to lactic acid. So, in a way, there is an accumulation of lactic acid in our blood. And pag dumami yung lactic acid in our blood, it will result to fatigue. No, kaya di ba napapagod tayo after some time, after doing some physical activity. Kasi dumadami yung lactic acid sa dugo. Okay, yun yung effect ng too much lactic acid. It gives us the feeling of fatigue. Alright? Okay, and pag may lactic acid, medyo apektado ang muscle contraction. Di kaya, ano, medyo apektado yung tawag natin sa sliding filament theory of muscle contraction if there's too much lactic acid. Okay, what about sa plant cell? So, in the absence of oxygen in the plant cell, the pyruvic acid also undergoes redox with NADH. So, NADH is oxidized to NAD. While pyruvic acid is reduced, no? And there is a molecule called acetaldehyde that will remove carbon in the form of carbon dioxide, forming alcohol or ethyl alcohol, and you have the release of carbon dioxide sa plants. Okay, and this is the main process involved in the manufacture of alcoholic beverages. Okay, like wine and beer. Ito, alcoholic fermentation. Okay, so there is a release of carbon dioxide and pyruvic acid is converted into ethyl alcohol. Okay, guys? Sige, anyway, this is not our main focus. Ang focus natin yung Krebs cycle. So, in the presence of oxygen, pyruvic acid will undergo a transition reaction. So, ano tong transition reaction na ito? Alright, so, okay, everybody, look at this diagram. So, pyruvic acid will react again with NAD. Yan o, NAD. So, NAD is reduced to NADH. And coenzyme A in the mitochondria, because this occurs in the mitochondria, coenzyme A removes a carbon atom to pyruvic acid. If you will look closely in our illustration, di ba, pyruvic acid is a 3-carbon compound. Okay, this coenzyme A will remove a carbon and react with oxygen, forming carbon dioxide. The result is a 2-carbon molecule called acetyl coenzyme A. Alright? And this acetyl coenzyme A will react with the citric acid cycle or the Krebs cycle. Okay? Yun yung tinatawag natin na transition reaction. Kasi ang Krebs cycle, hindi yan tatanggapin ng ano, hindi siya tumatanggap ng pyruvic acid. The pyruvic acid must be converted first into acetyl coenzyme A. So, ito yung tinatawag natin na transition reaction. Alright? So, again, in step number one, pyruvic acid, which is a 3-carbon compound, enters the mitochondria in the presence of oxygen. Alright? So, it reacts with the coenzyme A, removing a carbon atom in the form of carbon dioxide. Diba? Then, in step number two, there's redox with NAD. NAD is reduced to NADH, while pyruvic acid is oxidized. And at the same time, coenzyme A reacts to the reaction, forming acetyl coenzyme A, which is a 2-carbon compound. Acetyl coenzyme A then enters the Krebs cycle. Alright guys? Okay, so i-summarize natin itong transition reaction. So pyruvic acid to acetyl coenzyme A. So there is an enzyme that removes a carbon from pyruvic acid in the form of carbon dioxide. This is accompanied by redox. So NAD is reduced to NADH, while pyruvic acid is oxidized, leaving behind a 2-carbon acetyl compound. No? Kasi yung coenzyme A kakabit dyan, forming acetyl coenzyme A. And acetyl coenzyme A now enters the Krebs cycle. Okay, guys? Alright. Sige. So, ito yung tinatawag natin na pyruvic acid to acetyl coenzyme A or the transition reaction. Okay, so I guess we can now proceed to the Krebs cycle. Okay, makinig kayo guys, ito yung ating simplified diagram ng Krebs cycle. Again, the Krebs cycle occurs in the matrix, no, sa mitochondrial matrix. And the Krebs cycle, by the way, is ano to, similar to yung Calvin cycle, nasa Calvin cycle. Kaya lang malaking diferensya. Pero hinahambing ko lang sa Calvin cycle. Alright? Okay guys, so our raw material here is acetyl coenzyme A. O medyo tutok lang tayo ha guys ha. Maraming reactions dito eh. So acetyl coenzyme A first reacts with oxaloacetic acid. Ito yung first reaction, no? So, acetyl coenzyme A reacts with oxaloacetic acid, forming citric acid. That is the first product of the reaction, citric acid. That's why the Krebs cycle is also known as the citric acid cycle. Because the first reaction between acetyl coenzyme A and oxaloacetic acid produces citric acid. Okay, let's continue. Okay, nasa na ba tayo? Citric acid. Now, citric acid will undergo a reaction wherein there is a removal of a water molecule. So, a water molecule is removed from citric acid, forming its isomer. no, isocitric acid. All right. And in the next reaction, isocitric acid will undergo two reactions. First, we have the removal of a carbon atom and reacting with oxygen in the form of carbon dioxide. So again, the Krebs cycle is aerobic, no? A reaction that needs oxygen. So the Krebs cycle is a type of aerobic respiration. All right, and in the second part of the reaction sa isocitric acid, you have redox with NAD. So NAD is reduced to NADH, while isocitric acid is oxidized to alpha-ketoglutaric acid. Okay, same reactions occur in alpha-keto. You have the removal of a carbon in the form of carbon dioxide. By the way, class, when we talk of removing carbon from the Krebs cycle, we call that decarboxylation. Okay, removing carbon and forming carbon dioxide, you call that decarboxylation. And again, if you will look closely in alpha-keto, there's also redox with NAD. So NAD is reduced to NADH. Alpha-keto is oxidized to succinyl coenzyme A. And may kulang dito, mayroon pala nag-react na coenzyme A dyan, na forming alpha succinyl coenzyme A. So in alpha keto, tatlo, ha, there are three reactions involved. We have decarboxylation, yung removal of carbon dioxide, redox of NAD forming NADH, and coenzyme A reacts with alpha keto forming succinyl coenzyme A. Now, succinyl coenzyme A is unstable. Unstable yan, no? Highly reactive yung molecule na yan. So, to make it stable, succinyl coenzyme A releases a phosphate group. And that phosphate group is added to ADP, forming one molecule of ATP. And succinyl coenzyme A becomes succinic acid. Okay, guys? Alright, now look closely at succinate or succinic acid. Succinic acid will undergo a reaction, redox reaction with FAD. FAD is similar to NADH. FAD stands for flavine adenine dinucleotide, which is also a hydrogen acceptor molecule like NAD. So FAD is reduced to FADH. Succinic acid is oxidized to formic acid. Alright? Okay, in the next reaction, formic acid reacts with water. Water enters the reaction. Diba kanina yung water natanggal sa citric acid? O ito, babalik ulit yung water dito sa formic acid. So water reacts with formic acid, forming malic acid or malate. Alright? Okay, in the next reaction, malic acid reacts with NAD, so redox. So NAD is reduced to NADH. Malic acid or malate is oxidized to oxaloacetic acid. Oxaloacetic acid reacts again with acetyl coenzyme A, forming citric acid. And the cycle continues. That's it, guys. Very easy. Okay, that's the Krebs cycle. Okay, so before we continue, mag-accounting muna tayo. We will include here the transition reaction. Alright? So unahin muna natin, ano ba yung mga compounds na na-release, including the transition reaction? Alright, number one, carbon dioxide. Diba, no? So bilangin natin yung carbon dioxide na na-release. Okay, in the transition reaction, you have one. Okay, 1 dito, then ito pa, 2, sa 2, ito, ano na to ha, Krebs cycle, 2, 3, meron pa ba? Wala na, no, wala na, so 1 sa transition reaction, 2 dito sa isocitric acid, and 3 sa alpha-keto, so 3, di ba no, 3, carbon dioxide. Okay, ano pa yung mga lumabas? NADH. Diba? NADH. Isama natin yung transition. O, ilang NADH lahat. So, you have here 1. O, sa transition, 1. Okay? Then, ito, 2. 3. 4. 4. Diba na? Tamba, apat, no? One sa transition, then dito sa Krebs, 2, 3, 4. Apat, no? Apat na NADH. So, tatlong carbon dioxide, apat na NADH. Ano pang lumabas? ATP. O, ilang ATP? Isa. Ano pang lumabas? FADH. O, ilang FADH? Isa. Right? Okay. But wait! There's more. Alright? O, ilan? Balik tayo sa transition. Ilang pyruvic acids ba ang naproduce ng glycolysis? Diba dalawa? Right? Dalawa. So, that means, dalawang acetyl coenzyme A ang na-produce sa transition reaction. So, that means that the Krebs, ito yung transition and the Krebs cycle must turn twice. So, i-times to ngayon natin. Tatlong carbon dioxide, dalawang beses umikot, edi anim. Alright? So, then apat na NADH, dalawang ikot, edi walo. Then, isang ATP, pero dalawang ikot to, dalawa. Dalawang ATP. And dalawang FADH. Right, guys? Okay ba? So, tingnan natin, no? O, oh, walo. Ano, 6 carbon dioxide kasi dalawang ikot to eh. O, oh, dalawang ATP sa Krebs. Then, 8 NADH. Diba? 4 yung bilang natin kanina, eh, times 2. So, walo. Alright, dalawang FADH din yung na-produce. Okay, ano ba ngayon na mangyayari sa NADH and FADH? Diba, anong dinadala nila? Hydrogen. High energy electrons. Diba? So, sa ngayon pupunta yan? Pupunta ngayon sa ETC, sa electron transport chain. Alright? What happens to carbon dioxide? E di yan ang ini-exhale natin. We exhale carbon dioxide as a waste product. What happens to ATP? Di gagamitin ng cell for its metabolic activities. Ganun. Alright, guys. Okay. So, let us now proceed dun sa fate ng NADH and FADH. Let us now proceed to the electron transport chain. Okay. So, again, this diagram will help us summarize everything. So, the Krebs cycle releases 6 carbon dioxide molecules, 2 ATP, 2 FADH, and 8, tama ba? 8 NADH, dalawa sa transition reaction, and 6 sa Krebs cycle. Alright? Okay, what happens now to NADH and FADH? So, NADH and FADH will go to the electron transport chain, which is actually made up of a series of electron carrier molecules called cytochromes. Very similar to photosynthesis. Okay, so puro redox lang. Parang sa photosynthesis din. No, kaya lang, di ba, ang photosynthesis, dalawa yung cytochrome enzymes, di ba? Plastoquinone and plastocyanine. Ito naman, marami, no? May quinone, may FMN, flavin mononucleotide, cytochrome B, cytochrome C. Ito yung mga, ano to, cytochrome enzymes that will affect redox. No? So, habang bumababa yung high energy electrons dyan, the energy of the electrons are released. Okay? So, nakikita nyo ba itong smiley face sa ating PowerPoint slide? So, yung smiley face na yan, let's imagine na that's the high energy electrons from the Krebs cycle and sa transition reaction. Ayan, no? So, itong high energy electrons from NADH and FADH will be accepted by FMN. FMN is reduced while NADH and FADH are oxidized. Then, FMN will transfer the high energy electrons to the next cytochrome enzyme, yung quinone. So, quinone is reduced, FMN is oxidized. Then quinone transfers the high energy electrons to cytochrome B. Cytochrome B is reduced, quinone is oxidized. Then cytochrome B transfers the electrons to cytochrome C1. Cytochrome C1 is reduced, cytochrome B is oxidized. Then cytochrome C1 transfers the electrons to cytochrome C. Cytochrome C is reduced, cytochrome C1 is oxidized. Then cytochrome C transfers the electrons to cytochrome A. Cytochrome A is reduced, cytochrome C is oxidized. Then cytochrome A transfers the electrons to cytochrome A3. Cytochrome A3 is reduced, cytochrome A is oxidized. And the final electron acceptor molecule is oxygen. So nakikita niyo na no, ang ETC is a type of aerobic respiration kasi kailangan ng oxygen dito. So the final electron acceptor molecule is oxygen. So hydrogen plus oxygen, you form water. Diba? So the final product is water sa ETC. And as the electrons goes down the chain, energy is released. Alright? Energy is released. Okay, ngayon ang tanong, saan ngayon napupunta yung energy na yan? Now, that energy is used by the cell to power proton pump. So, ito yung ibig ko sabihin dito, no, habang bumababa yung electrons down the chain, no, through redox, reduction, oxidation, ayan, no, energy is released. Ayan, di ba? So, inaccept, reduce, then yung pinamigay na electron na oxidize siya. So, ganun lang. That's ETC, guys. So, as the electrons goes down the chain, energy is released. And that energy is used to power proton pumps embedded in the cristae of the mitochondria. Okay, mga proton pumps. The energy is used to power proton pumps. Okay, dito muna tayo. Bago yan, 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 ito. Okay, that are embedded in the cristae. So, yung mga hydrogen na ito, these proton pumps will pump hydrogen ions from the matrix to the intermembrane space. Alam niyo di ba yung intermembrane space, yung area between the inner and the outer membrane. So, these proton pumps will pump hydrogen ions from the matrix, as you could see in our animation, from the matrix to the intermembrane space. Alright? So, ano ngayon na nangyayari? So, there is now a concentration gradient. Alright? So, we have here a greater concentration of hydrogen ions in the intermembrane space. So, yung green. Yung matrix, yung orange. Okay. Kasi, di ba, yung mga proton pumps, ginamit yung energy para ipump yung hydrogen ions from matrix to intermembrane space, creating a concentration gradient. O, di ba? So, alam nyo na ito, no? So, dapat mabalansa yung concentration. Now, embedded in the cristae is a special protein known as ATP synthase. So, dito ngayon lulusot or dito ngayon papasok yung mga hydrogen ions in order to equalize the concentration. So, yung mga hydrogen ions from the intermembrane space will pass through the ATP synthase protein and there is phosphorylation. No? ADP is phosphorylated to ATP. Guys, this is what we call chemiosmosis. ATP is produced through chemiosmosis. And in one glucose molecule, there are how many ATP produced by the ETC? 34. Alright? 34 ATP. Okay, guys. So, this process is known as chemiosmosis. Most of the ATP is produced through chemiosmosis. 34 molecules of ATP. Okay? Any questions, guys? Oh, sige, mag-accounting ngayon tayo, ha? Yung lahat-lahat. Di ba madali lang? Alright? Sige, mag-accounting muna tayo. So, ilang ATP all in all? So, sa glycolysis, dalawa. Diba? Sa Krebs, dalawa. Ang ETC, 34. So, 34 plus 2 plus 2, 38. Oh, 34, 36, 38 molecules of ATP all in all. Alright, guys? But wait. diba? Balik tayo sa glycolysis. Diba ang nilabas din ng glycolysis, aside from pyruvic acid, you have two molecules of NADH na nasa cytoplasm. Ngayon, itong NADH is also a source of electrons, high energy electrons, na pwedeng gamitin sa ETC, sa loob ng mitochondria. So, ang nangyayari ngayon dito, yung NADH na nasa cytoplasm will enter the mitochondria through active transport. Kasi double membrane ito eh. No? Hindi ordinaryong diffusion ang kaya dyan. It must be active transport. No? And the active transport of NADH to the mitochondria, to the electron transport chain, will entail ATP. Kailangan ng ATP. Di ba active transport uses ATP? And dalawa ito. No, so the reaction will use up two molecules of ATP. No, the active transport of NADH from glycolysis to the ETC. So, 38 minus 2 because of the active transport of NADH to the mitochondria, ang suma total niyan is only 36 ATP molecules.